what I need Saturday Night Live to improve on, or what I need the liberals to improve on, is if he don't look good, we don't look good. This is our president. He has to be the freshest, the flyest planes, the best factories, and we have to make our core be empowered. We have to bring jobs into America, because our best export is entertainment and ideas. But when we make everything in China and not in America, then we're cheating on our country. And we're putting people in positions to have to do illegal things to end up in the cheapest factory ever, the prison system.
And that was Kanye West, rap superstar, holding court at the White House on Thursday. Not always, it has to be said, making total sense. We didn't even show you the part where he says that putting on the Make America Great Again hat makes him feel like Superman. Anyway, in contrast to Kanye, here is Tom Morello of Rage Against the Machine and Prophets of Rage fame. His new album just came out an hour ago. He sat down with my colleague John Vaughs for a conversation about the problems that he feels are confronting the United States: police shootings, global warming, and how he feels the 45th president is making a bad situation a whole lot worse.
And legendary musician, human rights and political activist Tom Morello, all-round good human being as well, joins us here for more. Congratulations on this new album. You know, I was listening to it, and you know, it really does. It packs quite a punch. You know, you guys got a lot to say. And in fact, a couple of months ago, you said about the Atlas Underground, amid this heightened sense of impending doom, it's now time to rally the troops in a last-ditch effort to save the planet and our artistic souls. By challenging the boundaries of what music is, has sounded like before, you can open people's eyes to changing the status quo in society. Okay, I mean, that's a pretty bleak outlook.
Well, I don't know. It depends on how you look at it. I think more than the music industry needs to be shaken up.
Right.
And the Atlas Underground is a sonic conspiracy. It's diverse artists with like-minded opinions who have come together to make a forceful, powerful musical and political statement in 2018.
One foot in the shadows, one foot on the brakes, one foot toward the gallows where it's quiet and safe. Every step that I take.
Incredible group of big names that come together for this album. And you talked about this new genre. Again, to quote you, there has never been a successful social movement in this country that has not had a great soundtrack.
That's right.
Is this the soundtrack for social justice for
the
21st century?
The resistance needs a jukebox.
Yeah. one song is on
and I'm hoping to add one or two 45s to that jukebox with this record. But I want to really try to create a brand new genre. The humble approach was to create a brand new genre of music that combines the Marshall Stack rock and roll riffing and guitar soloing that I'm known for with the huge EDM drops of 2018. Yeah. Electronic wizardry matched with scintillating guitar playing was what was the musical underpinnings of the Atlas Underground.
And there is plenty of that all the way through this. But I want to make some of the tracks. Lead Poisoning, which is the last track on the album. And Lead Poisoning, for those who don't know, it's basically slang mostly used by African Americans for basically dying from gunshot wounds, often from the police. And you asked the question, why are so many African American men being shot by the police in this track? And I want to ask you about one line in particular, but first here it is. I want you to listen to this.
Some say it's trigger happy, I say it's lead poisoning. Something that's deeply rooted in official embroidery. The difference ripped from all the holes is the bullets. With the valve or trigger, just a different figure to pull it. Murdered by the state like the cousin of John the Baptist. As if black youths are nothing but target practice.
So whether it's water hoses or bullets, a valve or a trigger, essentially what you're saying, nothing has really changed in this country since the 50s. Because this comes up again in another song about social justice, We Don't Need You. And again, here's part of it. And we'll talk on the other side.
Don't lie to me. Don't lie to me. The poor go to war. There's no war on poverty. Don't lie to me. Don't lie to me. Brown versus Board never gave us equality.
And again, Brown versus Board never gave us equality. It's the same thing coming back. Essentially, that not much has changed in this country. So is this a problem? White middle-class America thinks the whole issue of racism, it's done. There's a black president, two terms. We're done with it. Whereas you know, for the black community, they live a very different life day in, day out.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, well, the first track features RZA and GZA from Wu-Tang Clan. The second, Vic Mensa, incredibly talented, revolutionary, radical rappers. But, you know, the murder of African-Americans by the police is as American as baseball or apple pie.
Right.
But what's new is now we're seeing it on cell phones regularly. But that incessant drumbeat of those murders and police getting away scot-free is what is at the core of the problem. And, you know, while I know many police officers, and many of them are good people, but until they begin telling on their own and the blue coat of silence goes away, we'll never get any kind of justice unless we demand justice in the streets.
So until the life of an African-American man is worth more than silence among brotherhood of police, and you think nothing will change?
Yeah, and I'm not going to hold my breath for that, but you know, as an artist, it's a job both to reflect and try to change society, in my view. Mm-hmm. So with songs like Rabbit's Revenge, Lead Poisoning, and We Don't Need You, we're putting a mirror up to society, and that mirror is hopefully reflecting some light to both, you know, stir up controversy in the mosh pit and on the dance floor.
And in Rabbit's Revenge, you name check some of the victims, the African-American man who's been shot dead by police. Here's part of the song.
Fight for my life like a motherf***ing Trayvon. Fight for my life like a motherf***ing Mike Brown. Cause I refuse to be the next shot down.
So how important is it that these names are out there, that they continually be mentioned, you know, because we've got a very short memory in this
country. Yeah, I think it's crucial. I mean, that's Big Boy and Killer Mike on that track with that militant poetry. But yeah, too often these names are on the, you know, page 5 to begin with, and they're page 16 the next day, and they're written out of history. The lyrical theme that goes through this Atlas Underground record is social justice ghost stories. The idea that the heroes and martyrs and those murdered by injustice in the past can inform the present and shine a beacon light to hopefully create a more humane and just future.
Because you mentioned this, you see this sort of natural connection between music and activism, political activism, or human rights activism, and you think artists have this responsibility to speak out. Back in 2016, before the presidential election, you did speak out against Donald Trump. Here's a clip.
Hi, I'm Tom Morello, and I'm standing up against old man Trump. Because when it comes to race relations, he's like an old school segregationist. When it comes to foreign policy, he's like an old school napalmist. When it comes to women's issues, he's like a frat house rapist. So let's not elect that guy, and I want you to stand up against old man Trump.
Okay, you also told the LA Times back then, this election season, it feels like we are in Pompeii, with the volcano erupting and the only boat out of town is the Titanic. Yeah, I mean, we had this a lot. Essentially, you know, they're just as bad as each other, Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what's the difference here? Now we're almost halfway through this first term of President Trump. How do you see it? I mean, is it better than you thought it would be? Is it worse than you thought it would be? And would a Hillary Clinton presidency beat any better?
For 2 years, I was the scheduling secretary for U.S. Senator Alan Cranston. So I got to see how the sausage is made, you know, in a progressive Democrat's office. And it's, you know, it's as ugly as you think and add 2 zeros. Mm. So I understand people's. I also come from Trump country, too, like Lake County, Illinois. Democrats don't even run there. Right. So I understand this reticence to embrace a system that seems to have let down a lot of people. I believe that the underlying problems, whether it's a Democratic administration or Republican one, whether it's Trump and his histrionics or, you know, a more erudite Barack Obama, are systemic. And until we address those underlying systemic problems, it'll allow a fertile field for demagogues like Trump to use the oldest tricks in the book, racism, like blame the Mexicans, blame the immigrants, to divide us rather than uniting for a more just and humane country.
What did you say? We're not going to fix the master's house with the master's tools.
I don't think that that's possible. Yeah.
Why?
Why is it not possible to fix the master's house with the master's tools? I mean, because they're tainted to begin with. And I think that if we really look at, we have to decide what is it that we really want. First of all, I think that the impending environmental disaster that's facing us all now, I have young kids. And so looking to a future where there may not be an organized society because of global warming is something that's very frightening. Now, in the short term, the stuff that's on the table, whether it's the centrist Democrats or whether it's the Republicans, you know, left to the right of Attila the Hun,
right,
are all policies that I think are not in the service of humanity. We really need to look deep. And I get to see and talk to young people at every show, backstage at every show, see them in mosh pit. They want something different, fundamentally different, that has not been on the table for some time in the United States.
Okay, so lighten it up a little bit, because you talk about, you know, having these conversations with young people, also at your concerts. You make it pretty clear what you think of President Trump, the 45th president. There's a sign on the back of your guitar, and I guess you hold it up, and we can't say what that first word is, but it starts with F. Two of these photographs were taken in California. I think the last one there was taken in Spain. Yep. So when you hold up that guitar, I know it's a very particular crowd, yep. But is the reaction universal, or is there some difference depending on where you
are? There's normally a, you know, it's a, first of all, it's not a time necessarily for subtle statements, and particularly at a rock show. And that, it seems to, whether you're in Sao Paulo or whether you're in Buenos Aires or whether you're in Johannesburg or whether you're in Peoria, Illinois, people seem to respond to
right.
that.
Okay, well, we've got the November midterm elections just a few weeks away. The results will likely determine, you know, the future of the Trump presidency, mm-hmm. and you know, what will happen in the 2 years after this. You recently tweeted out, fight back against voter suppression and Russian hacking. Visit don'tgetpurged.org to make sure you are still on the state's voter roll. You know, we started out this conversation about talking about, you know, the impending doom and time mm-hmm. to rally the mm-hmm. troops, and this is the hour. And it's all, that's very grand talk, but mm-hmm. ultimately, at the end of the day, this country has a very simple mechanism for fixing a system if you think it's broken and needs to be mm-hmm. fixed. And that's as difficult as it could be for some people. It's get out and vote. You don't have to, you know, yeah. raid the White House with your pitchforks and torches.
Though that might not be a bad idea. Either.
That might be
a bad
idea. It could be just a few weeks away.
Yeah. But, you know, I would suggest that there are multiple ways to address the system. One is, you know, there are a lot of people who sacrificed a lot to get the right to vote. And I always vote. But I think that there are additional ways, like organizing, direct action. Those are ways to sort of confront a system, injustices in a system that historically have been just as effective or more effective sometimes than the ballot box. But I always vote, and I encourage people to do that as well. You can't just cast that ballot into the void every 2 or 4 years and expect there to be systemic change. Systemic change is something that we have to organize for on a much larger basis.
Tom, thank you.
Always a pleasure.
Good luck with the album. Good to talk to you. Thanks for coming in. We'll take a short break. You're watching CNN. News continues right after this.